I don't think so.
And he needs wine.
Hello. Good evening. My name is Dan Mills. I'm a member of the board and serve as treasurer. I'd like to... Excuse me?
Don't talk until they be quiet.
Oh, make them be quiet first. My name is Dan Mills. I serve on the board of Champaign County Healthcare Consumers as treasurer. And I would like to welcome you all here tonight for our annual awards dinner. And thank you all for being here and joining us. Every year we hold our annual awards dinner. That's why it's called an annual awards dinner, I guess. to celebrate the struggles and victories of the past year and to honor those individuals and organizations who have distinguished themselves in the pursuit of social justice and quality health care. Tonight's annual dinner is a very special event because in addition to it being a chance to award our recipients, this dinner is special because it celebrates our 30th anniversary as a grassroots social justice organization. So once again, on behalf of Healthcare Consumers, I welcome you and thank you for being here tonight. I also thank you for all the years you've supported our organization and been with us, working in struggle, working for justice, and working for quality health care for all.
Yes.
Before I introduce you to the Healthcare Consumers staff, I would like to take a moment to acknowledge the people and businesses who have contributed to help make our dinner a success. And also I would like to remark, in a sort of authoritarian manner, that perhaps you could turn off any cell phones or TVs or whatever electrical devices you might be carrying with you. That said, I'd also like to pay tribute to the arts by recognizing our musicians. Who, like many musicians, if they're like a lot of musicians, they're probably going to get something to drink at the bar. But maybe not. Anyway, these musicians are Jeff Helgenson on trumpet, Chick McNeil on keyboard, and Ed Scheller on bass. I'd also like to make a special thanks to our two hospitals who purchased and contributed to our honorary tables for this evening, Provena Covenant Medical Center for the Mary Louise White table, and and Carroll Foundation Hospital for the Harry J. Baker table. When Claudia gave me this assignment, she said I'd be fine, just be myself, and she, in her usual thorough manner, gave me 6 pages of notes. So if you'll bear with me here, you see me clinging to these notes, I've got fingerprints in them, I think. I also want to thank the many businesses and individuals who contributed to this event, and they are listed on page 4 of our ad book program. I also want to thank our fine volunteers and interns who have given their time to help to do registration, give rides to others, and perform every other imaginable task needed to make this evening possible. Oh, now Claudia says, say something nice about us here. Okay, well, this is where Claudia demonstrates her genius for leadership, because my admiration for the staff is boundless. I've been associated with the organization for more than 10 years now, and throughout that time, I have never heard a harsh word said in that office. Any task that comes up, everybody pulls together. I'm very proud to be associated with this organization, even the fast I am. Let's see here. Oh, okay. It's now time for me to... It's now time for me to introduce our staff. So can I ask our staff members to step forward, please?
Where's Mike?
Is Mike there? Okay. Mike, staff members are Paulette Coleman. She's our community organizer. She's our community organizer and also helps to manage the Champaign County Healthcare Consumers Office. With a deft hand, I might add. Katie Coombs. Katie's the community organizer and the coordinator of the Medicare 100 Plus program. She runs meetings with charm and purpose.
Yes.
Mike Cruz. Mike is a federal work study staff member. He helps with organizing, and he's developing a new website. I'll give you some help with that, Eli. which will be up later this spring, so we'll look forward to that. Ann Gargano. Ann is also a federal work study staff member, and she helps with organizing and fundraising. Dorothy Green. Miss Bean is our front office receptionist, and she looks out for everyone. And she's sort of our gatekeeper, isn't she? Allison Jones. Allie is a community organizer, and many of you know her from the Action Alert email she sends out. Allie maintains our database and also works on the website.
Yeah.
And, Jeff Machota. Jeff's our bookkeeper, and he also helps us with a lot of our technology needs. So he's fittingly manning the technology this evening. Let's see. Oh, another page. Megan and Claire. You no doubt remember Megan from last year's dinner when she received the Advocate of the Year Award. Since then, Megan has joined our staff as hotline and dental programs coordinator.
Yeah.
And then there's Claudia.
Yay!
Our executive director. What else can we say about Claudia? Well, this year marks her 10th year on staff and her 8th year as executive director. Besides Mike Doyle, we surely should nod at Mike because he is our founder.
He's coming.
Oh, Mike is hard at work getting something. Besides Mike Doyle, she is the longest tenured staff member in our organization. My admiration for Claudia is really truly unbounded. I mean, I've watched her and tried to understand her management techniques, and a part of it is I think that she gets so much out of her staff. And I think this is because her staff loves her, and this is really a good testament to her ability as a leader, isn't it? Oh, and now, blessedly, I will ask Paulette Coleman to come up and introduce the board of directors.
Hello. Good evening, everyone. My name is Paulette Coleman, and I have the honor to introduce the Healthcare Consumers Board to you all. And I would like for our board members that can stand to stand. And I would like for our board members, when I call your name, right? And the ones that aren't able, just kind of throw something or wave your hand. After I introduce you to the board of directors, I will ask Claudia to come up here and tell you about our program for this evening. Oh, but Dan will be back to tell us more about what's going to happen tonight. The board of directors of the Healthcare Consumers is made up of individuals who volunteer their time to oversee the function and the well-being of the organization. They're responsible for setting direction that is that the organization takes for assuring that the organization stays true to its mission. And I say this year, but I think it's worth better. Sorry. And I say this year, as I say every year, the board of directors have the very heavy responsibility because on top of everything else, they are also responsible for all of the actions and the behaviors of the healthcare consumer staff. Oh, yeah. So if we do something that you don't like, talk to a board member. They will be happy to hear from you. We are very proud of and grateful to our board of directors. Healthcare consumers' progress and victories of the past 30 years would have never been possible without our board. Now, as I introduce each board member, please wave your hand or stand so that you can be recognized. She is not here tonight, but she is performing a play on the East Coast, but our chair of our board is Lisa Dixon. Our vice chair is Barb Pritchard. Our treasurer, you've already had the pleasure of meeting, Dan Mills. Secretary, Reverend Jim Holloman. Unfortunately, Jim is ill and couldn't be here, but I'd like to give him a hand of applause. Grant Antimine. Mr. Lloyd Carter. Flavors Northington. Lester Pritchard. Elizabeth Schoenebo. Yeah. And a longtime friend and supporter of the healthcare consumers, Jen Tayabji. Please join me in thanking these board members for their dedication and hard work. And now here's Dan to tell you about our evening. Oh, I'm sorry, Ms. Phyllis Clark. She's also on our board. And I must say, I am sorry for missing Ms. Phyllis Clark, because she provides us with the most wonderful phone-a-thon home-cooked meal. I don't know how I did that, so I apologize.
Thank you, Paulette. Paulette, are you walking with my notes? Thank you, dear. As a grassroots organization, we aren't supposed to be too smooth and polished, right? Let's see here. Paulette does that. Say something nice about the board? No, we did that. We did that, didn't we? I know it is. Here it is. It's numbered as 3. 2. Thank you, Paulette. Now I'd like to give you a quick overview of for tonight's dinner. Logistics, that is to say, the bathrooms are out the way and to the left. We already covered the telephones, which I haven't heard any of. I thought that we did that good. Let's see. Dinner and dessert are being served at the table. I guess you've probably figured that out. The bar in the lobby will stay open throughout the evening, so you should feel free to get up and get a drink whenever you care to. As we enjoy our dinner in each other's company, we will also enjoy the band at some point. And after dinner is served, we'll begin tonight's program. The first part of the program is a celebration of 30 years of Healthcare Consumers grassroots organizing for healthcare justice. A slideshow presentation reviewing the past 30 years. Our founder, Mike Doyle, will introduce the slideshow to you. This slideshow is just under 20 minutes. After the 30-year slideshow, it's 20 minutes, it really isn't 30 years, we'll begin the awards presentations, and then we will close with another slideshow presentation to showcase our work over the past year. Now I'd like to invite you to please enjoy your dinner and the music. Thank you.
For a second, I know many of you just got your food, so you should continue to eat. We're going to have a little entertainment. My name is Mike Doyle, former board member and staff person of the Champaign County Health Care Consumers. And as you'll see in a little bit, 30 years ago, this month actually, a group of people got together and came up with a group called the Champaign County Healthcare Consumers, and it's a long time ago. And I had dark hair, and I had a lot of hair. Well, not a lot, but more than I do now. And you know, it's been pretty amazing. Claudia asked me if I'd come up here and just introduce the 30-year slideshow, so I don't have anything really profound to say. But just thinking about it and looking at the pictures and going through it, how long the Healthcare Consumers has been around, and again, when it started, it was just a handful of people determined to do something about the healthcare crisis and something in our community to make a difference. And at the time, I don't think any of us had any idea that 30 years later we'd be sitting here celebrating the anniversary. But one of the things that strike me is, although I'm no longer on the board or the staff, I do work out of the office of the Healthcare Consumers, and you know, it's very energizing for me to come each day, and there's young people always coming into the office and getting involved in healthcare issues and trying to make it better in our community. You know, during the day, there's all kinds of individuals facing crises in their lives and having volunteers there to help them and address the concerns. And, you know, about 6 o'clock, starts to get a little quiet, but then around 6:30, people start walking back into the office, and there's one meeting or another going on. People talking about how to address issues as a group and a community and how to make a difference. And, you know, it's been going on for 30 years, and it's pretty incredible. There have been all kinds of people who have been part of the Champaign County Healthcare Consumers, and for the next few minutes, there's going to be a slideshow up here just reflecting back on some of those individuals and some of the times that have gone before us. And so here's the past 30 years of the Champaign County Healthcare Consumers. Thank you.
Thank you. believe in freedom.
supposed to come back up here, but boy, wasn't that great. Unbelievable.
Good evening, everybody. Again, I'm Claudia Lenhoff, the current director of the Healthcare Consumers, and thank you. Watching this slideshow, I just have to say that I am in awe of this incredible organization and all the thousands of people over our 30-year history who have helped make all of our struggles and victories possible. All the supporters, volunteers, task force members, and the board and the staff. And I'm also amazed, I had to go through literally thousands of photographs and had a lot of help putting this together, and Mike Doyle helped me figure out some photos, and I'm just amazed how many people have not only gone through the organization, but how many people have stuck with the organization for decades. All of us on staff know that it is by the grace of our supporters and volunteers that we are able to work as community organizers for this amazing organization. We are constantly inspired and energized by community members who take time from their busy lives to dedicate themselves to these struggles for healthcare justice. It is because of these people, all of you, that we have so much hope and so much desire to continue to do the hard work of community organizing. Our power as an organization comes from our numbers, not the number of people on staff, because really we're sort of less than 5 full-time equivalents, but from the number of people willing to stand up and take action. And I think most of you know we had a very hard year. We lost John Lee Johnson and our beloved Bill Mueller. But 30 years of power behind us and all of the people here not only helped us to survive that year, but to have an incredible year, as you will see later. And so thank you very much. We are now ready to move on with our program, but on a personal note, I wanted to thank you for allowing me the privilege to serve as the Healthcare Consumers Executive Director for the past 8 years, and hopefully with your support, and if I don't screw things up, for many more years to come. It's truly an honor. And now, Paulette is going to move us into the next part of our program, and bear with us as we put the awards in here. Let me We need somebody from staff with the key so we can raise the screen, please. I just wanted to say real quick, I wanted to have us do a thanks to the awesome crew and staff here at Hawthorne Suites and for the good meal and the excellent service. And we actually wanted to ask the people who are award recipients to please come forward and take a seat, and then when we are ready to do the awards presentation and we call you up, we'll ask you to come up on stage with us so that we can present the award to you. Except for the Medicare Task Force, there's so many of y'all, we'll probably do this up front over here. And then, was that all I needed to say? Okay, and then Paulette is actually presenting the first award.
Oh, I never saw that. Oh, I gave it to you. There we go. Thank you. Quiet always has a copy. This year we have 2 award recipients for the Henrietta DeBoer Volunteer of the Year Award. I have the privilege of presenting the first one of these 2, to Miss Olivia Brown.
Can you please join me?
Woo. Okay.
So right next to me, you hear all this stuff I got to say about you.
Ms. Brown is a dedicated volunteer. She works several times a week for our front desk receptionist. I knew Ms. Brown's children before I knew her. And the word was, keep it straight with her, because she did not take no stuff. I was like, oh, she didn't push up. Really, I am here to tell you that it is the truth. But as tough as Ms. Brown is, she is also kind and an understanding person, and that is the key when you are the manage, when you manage the front office of the healthcare consumers. The reception area, because many people from all walks of life show up at our door looking for help for someone to listen to their problem. And Ms. Brown is the smiling face that welcomes them in and finds out just what they need and who they need to talk to. Ms. Brown had started working with us last year, just a few days before we experienced the devastating loss of John Lee and Bill. Even though she was brand new, Ms. Brown was there for us. And through it all, she did, even though she didn't know Bill very well, she had just known him for a few days before he passed. And she only knew John Lee from the community. You would have not known that she didn't, because you would think that she had known him forever, because she was so supportive to us through this time. Ms. Brown was there for us in so many ways. She was really amazing and good to us. She took time to comfort us and care for us like we were her own children. Besides her work with us, Ms. Brown has learned to become an advocate for the residents of her apartment building. She always fills the bulletin boards with information that can help the residents advocate for themselves, which is true to the mission of the healthcare consumers, empowering people to make concrete improvements in their own lives. From mail-ins to filing, even turnout calls, Ms. Brown is ready to help. At any time, she's famous for the words, give it to me, let me get started. So, should have had this out. So, Ms. Brown, it is my pleasure to present you with this award.
Thank you.
Would Joy DeYoung come up here, please?
Joy.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Allison Jones, and I'm an organizer on staff with Champaign County Healthcare Consumers. I'm extremely pleased to present the second Volunteer of the Year Award tonight to a wonderful person and a great volunteer, Joy DeYoung. I met Joy nearly a year ago when my coworker Katie and I gave a class talk to a graduate level social work class at the University of Illinois. We give a lot of class talks throughout the year, and it's always an interesting experience. A lot of eyes just kind of glaze over and don't really listen to what we have to say, but there are always a lot of eyes who are excited and engaged and ready to learn more about social justice. So Joy, as always, was excited, eager, and ready to hear what we had to say, and got in touch with me after the class talk to learn more about healthcare consumers. And soon she began volunteering, and let me tell you, it made giving that class talk very worth it. So, Joy has grown from a volunteer who works on basic office tasks to someone who is presented at large community meetings and helps spearhead some of our fundraising efforts. She always shows up ready to work, has a great attitude, and truly has demonstrated herself as someone who cares about social justice. She's worked on women's health, Medicare rights, and our campaign to end the access to care crisis, among many, many other things. In the coming fall, Joy will be heading off to the Northeast to complete an internship for her master's in social work degree, but until then, I can assure you, she'll be volunteering at Healthcare Consumers. So, Joy, we are deeply grateful for all your hard work and dedication, and we can never thank you enough for all you do. So, it's with many thanks that we present to you the Henrietta DeBoer Volunteer of the Year Award.
Hi, my name is Megan McClare, and I'm hotline coordinator at Champaign County Healthcare Consumers. Every day, I work with the Consumer Health Hotline, which... Oh, sorry. This is my first time with the mic, guys. Every day, I work with our Consumer Health Hotline, through which we work to empower and provide assistance to people who are having problems with the healthcare system. Our goal in every hotline case is to work with the consumer, both to solve the problem at hand and to develop the skills necessary to address any future problems. And it's through the hotline that we often first hear of the latest issues that are affecting consumers in the community. Each year, we give the Amy Olson Advocate of the Year Award to a hotline advocate who has been especially helpful and central to the hotline's operation. And this year, we have chosen to honor two hotline advocates, Elizabeth Chappie and Aaron Mann. So would you guys please come on up? So Elizabeth began working on the hotline as an advocate this past summer, and right away Elizabeth showed her dedication to helping the community by putting in extra volunteer hours to help make up for the shortage of volunteers that we usually have during the summer break. And she continued doing so during the school year. She quickly became one of our dental resource experts as she became more acquainted with available dental programs. And she serves as one of the advocates who is responsible for doing the screening appointments for the dental referral program and for the adult dental access program that we just implemented with the Champaign-Urbana Public Health District. Elizabeth's workload has increased tremendously with the announcement of the adult dental access program, and our office now gets more than 20 calls a day regarding this new program. And Elizabeth has helped keep up with this new demand and with the high call volume, and she does it every day with grace and patience. Beyond working in our office as an advocate, Elizabeth is also ready and willing to go to our community meetings and to help consumers who are having problems with the healthcare system and who are looking for help. And now I'd like to tell you about Erin. Erin began working on the hotline this past fall, and she quickly learned the ropes of the hotline and demonstrated a skill in her ability to work with consumers on even the most complex cases. As a hotline advocate, Erin has been very dedicated, and we've been very fortunate that we've been able to rely on her. Because Erin is always in the office during her work shift when she's supposed to, and because she's always willing to do something extra, Erin ended up taking on a major additional responsibility this semester as a result of speaking with Claudia. And Erin began a huge research project in order to help the collaboration that is in progress between the Champaign-Urbana Public Health District, the Mental Health Board, and the healthcare consumers. Together, our organizations are looking for innovative healthcare and outreach education programs that rely on community health workers to provide information, referrals, and services to community members who don't have easy access to the healthcare system. Erin agreed to research community programs around the nation, and not only has she researched and cataloged the programs, but she's found the most appropriate models for Champaign County, but she's also talked to the people who run these programs, and she's presented her research to these organizations, and they have been very impressed with all of her work. And Erin's work is also the foundation that we're sure will eventually become a very important program in our community. Both Erin and Elizabeth's contributions to healthcare consumers have strengthened our hotline and community organizing efforts. And both Elizabeth and Erin will be graduating this year and have plans of working with the community and helping our people. And we wish you both the very best of luck. And Elizabeth and Erin, I am very honored to present both of you guys with the Amy Olson Advocate of the Year Award.
Good evening. My name is Katie Coombs, and I have the honor of presenting Stephanie Green with a special recognition award, so I'd like her to join me up here. With this award, Healthcare Consumers is recognizing an incredible young woman whom we at CCHCC are very fortunate and proud to count amongst our good friends and most reliable volunteers. In the CCHCC office, we have many wonderful student volunteers, but there are certain individuals who, in the course of their volunteer work, give so much and so willingly of themselves, it's hard to imagine us getting by without them. Stephanie is one of these special people. She's volunteered at CCHCC for almost three years now and has seen us through many changes. Stephanie's willingness to work on what needs to be done means she's done just about everything. Stephanie has worked as an advocate for the Consumer Health Hotline, where she assists clients with problems in the gentlest of manners. Stephanie has also studied Spanish and helps hotline clients who speak Spanish. She's gone to dental appointments and interpreted for clients during their exams, and she brings all of her talents to help CCHCC and her clients, and sometimes she just can't say no. Once, she even ended up helping a Spanish-speaking client get their cable installed. In addition to Stephanie's work directly with clients, she helped CCHCC improve our hotline and dental referral program. She worked with our hotline coordinator, Megan McClare, when they were both volunteers, to create order and systems to allow more volunteers to participate in the hotline. Stephanie's latest efforts have been in working to create CCHCC's Spanish translation project and working for greater language access and local healthcare providers. Stephanie is a senior now, and her time at CCHCC is coming to a close. We'll miss her because she's a friend and because she helps lighten the load, but we know that Stephanie will continue to work for improvements in the healthcare system and carry her experiences at CCHCC with her. So Stephanie, it gives me tremendous pleasure to present you with a special recognition award tonight. Okay, good evening. I get to present the Citizen Leadership Award to George Carlisle, so I'll ask him to come step up and stand next to me. Okay, it gives me great pleasure to present George Carlisle with the Healthcare Consumers Citizen Leadership Award tonight. The Citizen Leadership Award honors individual activists who use the mechanisms of participatory democracy to advocate for justice and who help others to do the same. There is no one more deserving than our good friend George Carlisle. I have known George for over 10 years now, since we first met when we were both volunteers on the public health referendum campaign. George has been a public health activist every step of the way throughout the 10 years of community organizing to create, expand, and improve local public health. He has attended county board meetings, spoken out at those meetings during public participation, written letters to the editor, and participated in our organizing meetings. George's involvement with Healthcare Consumers is not limited to the public health campaign. George has quickly become a leader in our Medicare task force and its efforts to get a real prescription drug plan under Part D. And later you'll hear more about the activities of the task force. But I just want to say that in keeping with his citizen leadership efforts, George is a phone tree leader on the task force, which means that he calls other members of the task force and asks them to take action and shows them how to take action, such as calling elected officials. In other words, George isn't just an activist on his own. He is constantly teaching and empowering others to be able to become activists and leaders by teaching them the avenues and skills of participatory democracy. Besides working on these campaigns, George participates in fundraising efforts, parties, and every imaginable action and gathering of ours. He's ubiquitous. George is a well-known activist in our community, and his activism isn't limited to the issues that Healthcare Consumers works on. However, everyone who knows George knows his dedication to our organization. Last year, George was the recipient of his church's Jean Kramer Heerman Peace with Justice Award, and he was described as having, quote, an abiding interest in promoting public health and being a longstanding member of Healthcare Consumers. George generously designated Healthcare Consumers to receive his portion of the $100 that was attached with that award. And I didn't write this into my speech, but I wanted to say that one of the things that George did too, in honor of Bill Mueller, who passed away about a year ago, is that George bought him a brick at the Krannert Center for Performing Arts, and that touched all of us. And Bill's family is here with us this evening.
All of us at Healthcare Consumers have deep respect, affection, and admiration for George. Besides his excellent work, George is a generous, kind, compassionate, dedicated, articulate, and brilliant person, and he is absolutely devoted to Healthcare Consumers. We are sad that George has to leave our community to go to Oklahoma to care for his ailing father. And though we will miss George's activism and his presence at all of our gatherings, we know his new community will greatly benefit from his presence. George, it is with deepest gratitude, respect, and love that we present you with the Citizen Leadership Award tonight.
Again, my name is still Katie Coombs. I'm here to present the Harry J. Baker Community Service Award to Family Service Senior Resource Center. Pat Babbage-Smith will be taking it, so come on up. The Harry J. Baker Community Service Award is intended to honor community members or organizations whose dedication and work towards healthcare justice stands out and makes a concrete difference in our work and the lives of people in our community. This year's recipient is the Senior Resource Center of Family Service. And we're pleased to present the award tonight to the Program Manager of the Senior Resource Center, Pat Babbage-Smith, who will accept the award on behalf of the agency. The Senior Resource Center is a vital organization in the lives of hundreds of Champaign County seniors. It could be thousands, but I didn't want to, you know, go too big. They have a long history of providing excellent service and assistance to people who need help. In January of 2006, the Senior Resource Center, like so many organizations dedicated to providing services to seniors, felt the crush of the Medicare Part D prescription drug program. Part D is the largest change to a federal program in decades, and as many CCHCC members know, it's not a simple benefit. It's challenging and the problems are serious. The problems mean that people are not getting the prescription drugs they need. When seniors in Champaign County need help with Part D, they could call a 1-800 number and try to make their way through an automated computer menu, or they could call the Senior Resource Center and talk to a real person and make an appointment to talk to a caseworker face-to-face about their needs. This is an invaluable resource in our community. The Senior Resource Center staff solve complicated problems seniors face with Part D and many other problems that seniors face. But the problems with Part D in particular are quite difficult. They take hours to resolve. Some take several appointments over a couple days. And the dedication of the staff to make sure that seniors' needs are met is really a wonderful resource to have for our community. So it gives me tremendous pleasure to present the Senior Resource Center of Family Service with the Harry J. Baker Community Service Award. Good evening again. As I said before, my name is Allison, and now I'm going to present CCHCC's Government Leadership Award. This award is presented to a local, state, or national government official or agency that has distinguished itself by showing leadership and advocating for the best interests of the people they represent and advancing the interests of consumers in healthcare policy. CCHCC has selected the Illinois Department of Financial and Professional Regulation for this award for their uncompromising leadership on the Illinois Pharmacy Access Rules. No one was able to come from the department to accept this award, but we still want to honor them and thank them very much. So, these pharmacy access rules have been essential to women's health to help ensure access to emergency contraception at the pharmacy. One of the rules requires pharmacists to fill all prescription contraceptions without hassles or delay, and the other rule mandates the posting of an informational sign that outlines women's rights to contraceptives. These rules have improved the lives of women across the state of Illinois. Because of this rule, Illinois women have not had to experience some of the same problems that women in other states have experienced as they've tried to access basic contraception at the pharmacy. Because of these rules, the state of Illinois has gained national attention as a leader and innovator in protecting women's rights.
Although it was the governor of Illinois that issued these rules, it's the Illinois Department of Financial and Professional Regulation that works to enforce the rules. Under the leadership of Dean Martinez, the department's secretary, they have not been satisfied to simply enforce the rules. Instead, the department has championed these rules and has been a leader in ensuring proper pharmacy compliance from the moment the rules went into effect. Without this agency and proper enforcement, these rules would have little effect on the lives of women in Illinois. So thank you to the department for all their hard work, and we are pleased to present the Government Leadership Award to the Illinois Department of Financial and Professional Regulation. I'm not gone yet. I'm pleased to present the next award, which is one of the Activists of the Year award. And this first award for Activists of the Year goes to Rachel White Domain, a longtime CCHCC volunteer and activist. So, you can join me. Rachel began volunteering with CCHCC several years ago through our Women's Health Task Force. Through our current campaign for access to emergency contraception, she has helped educate thousands of women about EC and has advocated to greater access for EC for women of all ages. Rachel is always willing to volunteer to participate in any event and work on any project, from basic tasks such as labeling a mailing or making a phone call, to higher level tasks such as speaking to elected officials and testifying at public hearings. Rachel understands the importance of all levels of community organizing and is always willing to do the work, which we appreciate. Although Rachel's work has been focused on women's health, she's contributed to other CCHCC projects, including the Spanish language access work, our website, and our access to care work. Year after year, Rachel's returned to healthcare consumers to volunteer, help build the organization, and make our women's health work extremely successful. So thank you so much, Rachel, for all your hard work and dedication over the years. You're truly a citizen leader and an activist, and this award is just a small token of recognition for your leadership, strength, vision, and commitment. It's with great honor that CCHCC recognizes the work for social justice you have done, and we know you will continue to do so for years to come. And although you're leaving us to go to law school in Chicago in the fall, you will always be part of the healthcare consumers family. So thank you.
Back once again too, and my name is Katie Coombs, and I'm going to be presenting the Activist of the Year Award to the CCHCC Medicare Task Force. So I'd ask if the task force members who are here this evening as representatives of the leaders could please come and stand in the front. There's quite a few of you, so if you could come up and stand in the front row here. Please join me, and I see some folks that are still at the table here in front. If you wouldn't mind coming on up, I'd really appreciate it. I don't want to be lonely. People are making their way up. I'll start talking, and by the end, we'll all be up here for the photo. The Activist of the Year Award goes to individuals who, through their activism, distinguish themselves in public service to the community, especially in areas of consumer health advocacy and healthcare justice. This year, the Medicare Task Force is honored with the Activist of the Year Award. Healthcare consumers organized the Medicare Task Force in the fall of 2005. The task force is led by Medicare beneficiaries and community members concerned about the negative impact of the Part D program. Some members of the Medicare task force have been personally harmed by the failures of Part D. Others have friends and family who have experienced problems, and some are concerned about federal funds subsidizing the profits of insurance and pharmaceutical industries. The members of the Medicare task force have spirit and energy. They discussed the problems with Part D and decided that they would do something to change the program to make it better. The task force set their sights on our representatives in Congress, and they haven't looked back since. The task force has educated our congressional representatives about the changes that need to be made to Part D. They've held community meetings, conducted a candidate survey, collected thousands of petition signatures supporting Part D reform, and much, much more. In order to accomplish so many things, the members of the Medicare Task Force meet each month to plan, strategize, and stay up to date on legislative developments. If the Medicare Task Force could have fixed the problems with Part D, they would have. Instead, they have worked to make sure that our representatives in Congress support fixing Part D. And this is no small task. Believe it or not, it's controversial to ask that a prescription drug benefit for seniors and people with disabilities be efficient and have the lowest drug prices possible. The Medicare Task Force should credit themselves with a major victory when Representative Tim Johnson voted to support authorizing Medicare to negotiate discounted drug prices against his personal beliefs. When the Medicare Task Force members state that they won't stop working until Part D is fixed, I believe them. I love I get to work with these dedicated individuals. It's an honor and a privilege, and it gives me tremendous pleasure to present the Medicare Task Force with the Activist of the Year Award tonight. Crone Muller to come up and present an impromptu award this evening.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Crone Muller, Bill's little brother, and you know, I actually at one time I thought I should prepare something for this because I'll probably stand up here and break up much like I did at his memorial service a year ago in Springfield. But you know, this is the first one of these I have come over to, and Bill always tried to talk me into it, and I never made it. You know, I can see, you know, he worked very hard on this and worked very hard along with all of you. And, you know, this event was a big deal to him. And sitting here this evening, I can see why. Because it's an opportunity for you all to sit back and say, holy shit, we accomplished a lot of you. And I think that's one of the reasons, you know, he just loved this. Needless to say, Mullers are always, you know, had a gift for getting up in front of people, so I'm going to keep this as short as possible. But anyway, you know, Bill really loved working with all the people here, and I think last year, you know, on behalf of the whole family, we want to thank everybody for all their support in our time of grief. It was, you know, very obviously not expected, and it was a very difficult time for all of us. But, you know, I think he would have been embarrassed at all the, you know, support that we got, and all the people that cared about him, but, you know, he cared equally about you. And part of it was the victories, not just the victories, but also the losses that you all shared. And sharing in a loss or a victory, you know, it brings people together. And you help one person, then they want to give back by helping the next person. That's how this, you know, obviously how this group has grown as it has over the years. It's just one person helping another, and I think that's wonderful. But in any event, one of the things that Bill desperately loved was the board meetings and the task force meetings. And of course, Claudia sits on a lot of those, and you know, and I've sat on a few such things, and it's very hard when you're chairing these things to keep everybody focused, and people's minds wander, and your minds are wandering right now thinking, who the hell is this guy? But it's really hard to keep people focused, not just, you know, people who are listening, who's thinking about 100 other things they have to do, but also the people that are talking who like to not focus on the task at hand. So that's a real challenge. So a person chairing a meeting like Claudia does so many, you know, that's a tough role to keep people quiet when it's not their turn to talk and keep people on task. And so, I don't know, the Mullers are also well known for wrapping things. It's the best I could do. But anyway, you know, Claudia was so wonderful last year, and as I say, has been very supportive over last year, and so this is just a small token of our esteem for her. And I want to thank her for that. For the benefit of those at the back, this is from a golf tournament that down in the southern part of the United States, and it's for keeping the gallery quiet, but it says, "Hush, y'all." And if you've ever talked to Claudia or gotten an email from her, you'll be familiar with that contraction.
Thank you very much. For those of you who participate in our task force meetings, board members, we'll be breaking this out all the time. Thank you all very much, and thank you for bringing back the Mueller humor to our event this evening. Before I do this, I wanted to say one thing. When you look at the ad book, take it home, look at it this evening. One of the things we forgot to mention earlier that we did special this year and that we want to continue to do is we put in the ad book the namesakes, the people after whom our awards are named, our honorary tables, and of course the our sustaining fund is named in honor of Bill. So it's the William Mueller Sustaining Fund. And if you look in the ad book, I think it's pages 9 through 13 or so, you can see the people after whom these awards are named. And it's a way of continuing to honor them as well as the current award recipients. And what you won't find in there is this next award, which is the Golden Bedpan Award. And Paulette is going to hold it as a prop. Thank you. This is hard to hold the bedpan because you end up with the photos and it's kind of undignified. It doesn't make your parents proud. It's tough. So Paulette is sacrificing something by doing this, and I appreciate it. Okay. So the last award of the evening is really a recognition to which no person or organization should aspire. The Healthcare Consumers Board of Directors awards the Golden Bedpan to the individual or group of individuals, corporation, or political body that has distinguished itself above all other things during the preceding year by its attack on the health and welfare of the people of its community. This year's recipient of the Golden Bedpan Award, and I want to thank Esther Pat for helping me to write this. And if you listen closely and if you know Esther and you speed up what I'm saying, you can just hear it flying off your tongue. I also want to thank Bob and Jerry Kirshner for, and especially Jerry, for getting me some concrete information on this. But here it goes. This year's recipient of the Golden Bedpan Award is a 2006-2007 Champaign City Council. Recognizing the Champaign City Council for its consistent policy of feeding the rich while starving the poor. The council has saddled the city's taxpayers with the cost of interest on loans the city has taken out to give millions of dollars to several wealthy developers while refusing to spend even one dime of city funds to ensure that the township could continue to provide health care to 50 extremely low-income people who would otherwise be eligible for township assistance. Linda Abernathy, the supervisor for the township, is very sorry she couldn't be here this evening. She was thrilled to hear about this award. The purpose of the township office is to provide general assistance, including a medical card, to any individual who is eligible. Most clients are people who are single adults and who have experienced a significant illness or a disabling condition and are waiting to qualify for disability benefits or to be able to get back on their feet after a time of hardship. Township assistance provided $212 in cash benefits to these individuals. Not a lot to live on, but a lifeline if that's all you've got. Unfortunately, a November referendum to properly fund the township failed in the city of Champaign, and the township office was forced to turn to the city council to request funding assistance so that township clients wouldn't lose this important support. At the very same time that the city council has been refusing to provide funding for the township and its clients to the tune of a measly $200,000, which is the minimum that Linda Abernathy requested for the township so that clients could continue to receive the $212 monthly stipend. At that very same time, the city council has approved spending over $29 million in tax incentives provided to five major developers, including $7.8 million for the former Burnham site, $4 million to the Clearview development where Christie Clinic plans to relocate while still refusing care to uninsured and people with Medicaid insurance, $5.56 million to the M2, y'all know that development on Neal Street, it's gotta have a, you know, fancy name like that, M2, on Neal Street, and a distinguished and outrageous $11 million for a parking deck related to M2 in downtown Champaign, which will require borrowing $8 million, and all to develop a downtown Champaign that caters to what the city council has called, quote, the creative class. So that they can live and work in downtown, because somehow, magically, providing housing and a place to work for this creative class will prove to be an economic windfall to the city. We say that the real creative class are the people who have to figure out how to make a life for themselves on $212 a month or less. Some creative folks, and they ought to be the ones getting the benefit. This is just outrageous. I can't hardly talk about it, but I will anyway. So although I think that the city council takes particular delight in refusing to help meet the needs of the township and its clients, the city council is also forging forward with these development projects at the expense of $40 million in unfunded road projects, an already outstanding debt of $24 million for the library and $33 million for other projects. I don't even have time to go into a discussion of the deeply incestuous relationships between city council members and some of the developers who are the beneficiaries of the council's newfound generosity, and the News Gazette, who also seems to be using its platform to be supporting these downtown development plans and the expenditure of millions of our dollars to do this. Unfortunately, some of these individuals with these incestuous relationships were just re-elected to the city council, so I think we can only expect more of the same. So tonight, for their massive failure to be good shepherds of Champaign's resources, and for their cold-hearted, willful neglect toward their low-income and disabled fellow citizens, while demonstrating great generosity toward their developer friends, in fact, so much generosity that you'd think they thought that this was their own money, we recognize the Champaign City Council with the Golden Bedpan Award. A note, an addendum to the Golden Bedpan Award, because what you heard wasn't bad enough. George has been involved with the CU Smoke-Free Alliance, which got an ordinance passed, a smoke-free ordinance, and a couple of the folks who just got re-elected may end up being able to repeal that ordinance. So more good news there. All right, thank you. Okay, now, I hope that you enjoyed our awards presentations. Thank you, Crone, for this. And now it's time for us to move on to the last part of tonight's program, and that is our annual slideshow, where in less than 7 minutes, we review the activities of the past year. It's been, again, an incredibly difficult year, but also a very uplifting and productive year with many accomplishments and many things to celebrate. So please sit back and enjoy the slideshow. Thank you. You probably wonder how we get so much work done when we're busy posing for photos all the time. We just treat everything like it's a photo op. So now that you've seen the slideshow, you can see some of what's ahead for us for this coming year. We will, of course, continue to fight for a real Medicare prescription drug benefit, and we're counting on the Medicare Task Force to lead the way. And I know all of us on staff and board are willing to put our trust and faith in this task force. We are hopeful that we may get state legislation passed to allow access to emergency contraception for women of all ages. We are going to gain momentum and strength in our community organizing efforts to put an end to the access to care crisis affecting close to 40% of our community members. This means that we're going to be targeting the clinics, Carle Clinic and Christie Clinic, to change their discriminatory policies and the state of Illinois to do what it can to ensure that our healthcare providers serve people with Medicaid insurance and the uninsured as well. Say this is going to be a major, major, massive organizing effort. You saw from the 30-year slideshow that we've been up against discrimination before. Mercy Hospital, Carle Clinic, Christie Clinic, we had to take to the streets, we had to march. Mike Doyle was talking about, you know, that at the time, sometimes there were only 40 doctors who took Medicaid. We don't even have that now. So the uninsured are affected. So I think we're facing a really massive struggle ahead. And all we know to do is to just never give up and to keep going. And so we're going to ask for your support with that because people's lives are on the line every single day because of that. And I think that you can look for amazing developments in our ongoing collaborative efforts to expand access to affordable dental care for low-income Champaign County adults. We have already developed an amazing partnership with Champaign-Urbana Public Health District, and those folks are here this evening. Thank you all for coming. The CUPHD deserves tremendous credit for agreeing to open up its dental clinic to low-income adults while at the same time maintaining their mission of serving the dental needs of children. And you're hearing this here first, but Carle Foundation Hospital, get this, wants to give healthcare consumers a significant amount of funding for us to expand our dental programs and eventually create a dental fund to help pay for extensive and expensive dental procedures. I'm sure that Carle will use their extensive resources to, you know, to announce this when it happens, so you'll be hearing about it publicly, but here you're hearing about it first, and we're really proud of that and grateful to them for their vision as well. So we have a lot of work ahead of us, a lot of struggles for justice, and the development of important new programs to help us make concrete improvements in people's lives. We are counting on you to help make these things a reality. And as if you all haven't done enough, you can start again tonight by, when you leave, going out to the action table in the lobby where you can sign petitions, pick up meeting announcements. We're going to have the first meeting of the Healthcare Access Task Force on Thursday, May 10th. So that's going to develop an organizing group that's going to lead the struggle. And there's other ways to take action and get involved. And also, I might add, we have new merchandise to sell out there. And all of that helps to support the organization so that we can do the work we do. We have new keychains, which you all get one tonight. And then there's more available for sale. We have beautiful tote bags. And of course, we have t-shirts and sweatshirts and so on. And now I want to close this evening by saying thank you once again to all our members and supporters and wonderful volunteers and in us just from coming and doing what they do with us. And we sorely needed that, and we're just so grateful, and we're gonna keep going on, of course. And also to the board, and who are just incredible people who believe in us and support us and help lead the way. And also the staff, and I just want to say to the staff, I couldn't love y'all any more than I do. And I think y'all are just amazing, amazing people, and I'm honored to be able to work with you, and of course all of our members. So it takes all of us to make this amazing work happen. Let's never give up the fight for healthcare justice. Thank you.